Hello everyone, welcome to session 6 of LTEC 620 Visual Design. Believe it or not, we've reached the final week of the summer semester. Before we get into this week's content, I want to remind us where we left off last week when we introduced the concept of pictorial competence and the different functions graphics can play in relation to text, such as decorational, representational, organizational, so on and so forth. And I mention that because I want to encourage all of you to review some of your previous work, such as your business card designs. What kind of graphic elements did you use in those designs? And importantly, what were the functions of those graphics in relation to the text on your business cards? Were they decorational? Were they interpretational? Of course, designing a business card is an interesting challenge. You have to work with a fairly standard amount of information, and you need to present it clearly in some kind of eye-catching way. And I think there are some really great examples here of excellent visual design. Now, of course, the Info Smash It assignment, where you were charged with designing an infographic, was by design meant to counter the limited size and options of a business card. And as you all realized, the infographic format is really wide open. It's large, and there's a lot of room for layout and compositional decisions. But one of the takeaways I hope you walk away from this class is, whether you're designing for a small space, such as a business card, or a large space, such as an infographic, it is important to A, design with intention, and B, learn to apply the various design principles we've been studying. And this brings us to the last assignment of the semester, Design Project 6, Expressive Timelines. Now, the purpose of this assignment is to give you one last chance to apply the principles of good design to communicate a sequence of events. In other words, a timeline. And your timeline can be related to any topic. Now, as you're probably aware, the last day of the semester is Thursday, July 2nd, and that's only a few days from today. And you are more than welcome to finish your timeline and hand it in on July 2nd if that works with your schedule. However, if you need a bit more time and would like to take the weekend, you can hand in your Design Project 6 on Monday, July 6th by midnight, and it will still count. All of the other parameters for this assignment are going to look very similar to Design Project 5. The size is up to you. It can really be any size. Assume, however, that you are going to print your timeline, so you might want to use one of these standard sizes. The orientation is up to you. I do expect you to use a grid in your design, and of course, whatever media you want to draw on to combine in your expressive timeline is up to you. And of course, as the reading suggested, we are interested in creating expressive timelines that are beautiful, sound, and utilitarian in the sense that they communicate a message clearly. Now, with that in mind, I've assigned a reading that's going to do a deep dive into timelines. And as you will see, there are three important dimensions to timelines. Now, one of those dimensions is the representation dimension. And as you can see here, this is kind of how you represent time. You can do that in a linear fashion, a radial fashion. You can use a grid, a spiral, or some arbitrary representation of time. Now, that's one dimension. The second dimension is scale. What scale are you going to use in order to represent time? One popular way is chronological, such as using dates or times. It can be a relative scale, a logarithmic scale, a sequential scale, or a combination of sequential and interim durations. And finally, the third dimension that you have to consider is layout. Are you going to lay out your timeline on one single unified timeline, or you can use multiple timelines or segmented timelines? And again, the article will go into all of these dimensions in detail. And I'm giving you a sneak preview of these dimensions because I want to emphasize one of the main ideas of the semester, which is everything is a design decision and they should be made with intention. Now, with that, I want to talk about the concept of design trade-offs. Now, the idea of design trade-offs in relation to learning design and technology was actually introduced by Alan Collins, a famous learner learning scientist at Northwestern University. This is a pretty old article at this point, but in 1996, he talked about this premise, this idea that anytime we're creating learning environments for learning, there are a multitude of design decisions that need to be made. I'm sharing that with you because what I want to do is replace learning environments with visual representations. So the premise now is, anytime we're creating visual representations for learning, there are a multitude of design decisions that need to be made. And Collins pointed out in his famous article that many decisions, unfortunately, are made unconsciously without considering consequences. And he argued that design decisions should be consciously considered. He elaborates in his article about an approach to making design decisions. And he argued that we should, as designers, think of each design decision in terms of its costs and benefits. And we can do that by answering these questions. What are the issues that must be addressed in designing visual representations? And what are the cost-benefit trade-offs associated with each design issue? And how should the costs and benefits be weighed? Now, Collins, in his article, elaborated that there are many design trade-offs, and here's a sampling of them from the article. He argued that one design trade-off has to do with memorization versus thoughtfulness. And we could kind of think of that as kind of surface learning versus deep, thoughtful, slower learning. Another design trade-off is, are we talking about the whole task or component skills? Are we focused on a breadth of knowledge versus depth of knowledge? Incidental versus direct learning? Fun versus serious learning, learner control versus computer control, and cognitive fidelity versus physical fidelity. Now, not all of these relate directly to visual design, but many of them do. And right now, I want to emphasize the last one here, cognitive fidelity versus physical fidelity. And so we can ask ourselves, what is the trade-off between preserving physical fidelity to the environment versus preserving only cognitive fidelity? And Collins argued that there are costs of stressing cognitive fidelity. And some of those costs mean learners may not recognize particular situations in the real world because they look different. In other words, if you're just focusing on the cognitive fidelity of a concept, learners, once they get out into the real world, may not recognize that what they learned is immediately applicable in the real world. In addition, important mappings for understanding a system may be lost, and representations that do not include a large portion of the mapping in reality risk hiding critical elements on which people rely in the real world. Now, on the flip side, what are the benefits of stressing cognitive fidelity? Well, it makes it possible to focus on the salient aspects of the situation or the concept. Another benefit is that learners do not get lost in the complexity, sometimes related to natural situations or real-world scenarios. And in addition, cognitive representations are often cheaper to create. Now, if this concept of physical fidelity versus cognitive fidelity is a little bit unclear, let's take a look at some examples. So here's an example of learning about a steam engine and how that might work in a train. In this particular picture, we see a visual representation that is really emphasizing the basics of the system. We can actually get rid of the elements of the train and just focus on what's important about understanding the steam engine. Now, in contrast, if we look at this example on the right, this is a much more realistic and physically accurate representation of a steam engine. And so basically what we're doing here is we're contrasting the cognitive versus the physical. And so the reason we're talking about this is, as designers of visual representations, there may be moments where you need to make decisions about which type of model is more appropriate for the topic you're covering for a given target audience. Here's another classic example. Now, on the left-hand side, we have the famous New York City subway map. And right on the map, it says, to show service more clearly, geography on this map has been modified. And the designers of this have actually called this helpful distortion. And that's the idea that there's a tension between the usability of the subway map and the geographic accuracy. Now, let's contrast this to, over on the right-hand side, Andrew Lynch's complete and geographically accurate New York City subway track map. And he's designed this map based on geographic and spatial data, satellite imagery, all of the old historic maps. And the first thing you'll notice is, by comparing these, is that Lynch's design on the right, which is geographically accurate, you can see that it's not up and down. It's actually pivoted a little bit. Because in reality, Manhattan isn't perfectly pointing directly north. And so even if we shift this and pivot it so that it's facing up and down, you can see the level of detail is quite different. Now, if we zoom in on just Grand Central Station, you can see on the left map, which is really trying to help people cognitively, it's just representing that station with a white circle. In contrast, with Lynch's physically accurate map on the right, you can see he's mapped out all of the different train tracks and how they're spatially aligned to each other. And of course, this is interesting and it's quite beautiful, but it's not necessarily helpful for anyone thinking about navigating the subway system. And I just wanted to show these different designs. There is quite a community of people that have a lot of fun creating different representations of this complex information. Now, I wanted to talk about cognitive versus physical fidelity because I think it's an excellent example of a design trade-off that you will ultimately face when designing visual representations. And when you are thinking about your final design for LTEC 620, you'll be thinking about the dimensions of timelines such as representation, scale, and layout, and some of the design trade-offs inherent in each of those design decisions. Okay, everyone, we're out of time for today. Have a great week, and I'll see you in Canvas.